Excited to get to connect with everyone today and talk a little bit more about how we teach food here at the college, as well as continue a series that we've been doing over the last few weeks about culinary-based cooking methods. We started off focusing on dry heat cooking methods, where we did a demonstration on sauté, which is a variation of dry heat cooking methods where we're using fat in the cooking process. We also did dry heat cooking methods with regard to grilling and roasting, where you're not going to be using direct fat contact with the cooking process. And then last week we did moist heat cooking, where we focused on blanching vegetables as well as doing a deep poach of salmon. And now this week we're getting to really what I feel is the holy grail of cooking methods, and that's getting into combination heat cooking methods. So it's really a combination of dry heat cooking and moist heat cooking that we work together and do a low and slow process to be able to take a piece of meat in most instances that is usually pretty tough, has a lot of fat in it, a lot of connective tissue, is usually fairly inexpensive, and turns it into a really delicate, delicious meal for customers to enjoy. Usually a great way for restaurants to lower their food costs, which is an important thing to keep in mind. When you're running a business, you want to keep your food costs as low as possible so that you're maximizing your profit. And the great way to do that is by purchasing lesser cuts of meat and turning them into something special. So today what we're going to be focusing on is the braising aspect of combination cooking. Another element of combination cooking is the stewing method. That I'm going to talk to you a little bit about. They're very similar in their approach and the process that you're going to go through to cook them, but there's some very specific differences that's going to separate the two. But today we're going to be making one of my all-time favorite foods, which is braised short ribs, and we're going to accompany that with some whipped mashed potatoes. Going to be fantastic. But you can see here with our short ribs, a lot of fat here, a very dense cut of meat, fairly inexpensive. They've gone up in price over the last few years as they've become really a lot more popular. One of the I guess the downsides to a lot of people becoming foodies is that they learn the glories of meats like this. So now that purveyors know that they can get a pretty good markup on a cut of meat like this, is usually how they can take advantage in terms of the retail market. But in terms of chefs working with an ingredient like this, it's all about putting love into your food and working with the ingredients in the proper way. So to get started with, what I'm going to talk through is really how we're going to begin our process. Over here on my right, I actually have some water going with our potatoes in here. So they're boiling, they're going to take a little bit of time, so I wanted to get them started ahead of time. But we've got some heavily seasoned water here with our potatoes that I started out at cold temperatures. So basically you want to start off with your potatoes in cold water. You don't want to just dump them into a raging boiling pot of water. You want them to come up gradually so that your potatoes will cook evenly and cook all the way through. So very important step within that. And I'm just using a basic russet potato, which has a very high starch content, really the perfect mashed potato potato to use for that capacity. But our main show here is, like I said, going to be our braised short ribs. And really one of the things that I love most about this is the fact that it's really about following a blueprint when we talk about going through this cooking method. Following the proper steps in the right order is always going to yield really the same results with regard to braising. And that's why that's an area that we focus on so much here at CIA, is understanding the science and the procedure that goes into cooking, because understanding that map and understanding those points are going to allow you to get great consistency and outcomes of your food and get that repeated time and time again. And really what we're changing in the process when we work with a cooking method is just the ingredients that are going into this. The recipe and the structure that I'm going to show you today, you can translate this to working with brisket. You can take this and working with chicken breast or like a whole chicken thighs that are usually very dense and have really a lot of connective tissue that are great for braising capacities. Really any kind of meat that you want to braise and cook for a long period of time, you're going to go with this method for the braising process. And the same thing for stew. Same type of element. If you're going to use a beef shank that you're going to cube up into small bite-sized pieces, that's the same exact approach that you're going to take as I start to work through this. So as we get going, first things first, most important is I've got my pan going already. We want to make sure that we have a nice hot pan to begin with, because the most important element is getting a nice initial sear on our short ribs. What this is going to do is it's going to incorporate flavor into our dish. It's going to flavor the meat, getting that nice caramelization on our meat is going to have that browning effect, but it's really going to make a nice rich flavor to it as well. And then we also want that because it's going to build some of the flavor profiles for the rest of our dish. We want to render out the fat from them so that we can use that to work into building our mirepoix and caramelizing that. So really this first step in the process, the searing of the meat, is really the most important part because it sets the tone for everything that comes later. If you get too dark with your searing and it actually starts to blacken, that can have really bitter afternotes that's going to carry through your entire dish. So you really want to be mindful of the temperature that you're working with in this element, but it's all about getting the technical term of what we call GB&D, and that's golden brown and delicious. So have that image in your mind from the very start, and you really won't go wrong. So we've got a nice liberal seasoning of our short ribs here that are ready to go. I'm going to take off one of my gloves. Take both off. Okay. And so our pan is coming up nicely. You want to make sure that you use a rondeau of some sort to do your braising in. You can use a Dutch oven as well, but it's really about having a pot that has a nice flat surface, a lot of surface area for the meat to have contact with, so you can get that good hard sear. But then you also want to have some high sides to your pot, so that way you have room for the liquids that we're going to add to there, and it's going to help generate steam. That's the most important part of that, the combination cooking, is that moisture that's going to help cook the meat and cook it slowly, but also that bottom element where we're going to get that nice hard sear and doing really the saute method to get our beef nice and brown. So we're going to go ahead and get our oil into our pan. We're just going to use a little bit. Like I said, we want to make sure that we render out some of our fat here for the from the short ribs themselves. They're going to build some nice flavor into our dish, but we want to have a little bit of vegetable oil here just from the very beginning, just to help kind of get that process started. Okay. And we're going to go in with these. We want to go fat side down first, so that's going to be the presentation side, and we want to put that side down first, so that way we can do take that rendering element that I was mentioning before and bring out all of that fat and all that flavor into our braising dish. Okay. Perfect. Now, one of the most important things to note with regard to properly searing meat in this element is making sure that your meat is very well dried ahead of time. I dried these off with a paper towel when I first started prepping them, and then I kept them in the refrigerator right underneath the cooler, so that way it was blowing cool air on it to keep it dry. Moisture is really the death of caramelization. Whether you're doing the stewing process or you're doing the braising element of things, you want to make sure that your meat is nice and dry, so that way it develops that caramelization. If too much moisture starts to come out, it's going to generate that steam, and you're not going to develop that nice brown color that we're looking for. Another important thing to keep in mind is using the right type of oil. I'm just using a standard vegetable oil here, which is a very high smoke point when we talk about working with foods and working at a high temperature. Using specific oils for specific tasks. If we try to use an extra virgin olive oil, which has a lot of impurities in it, has a lot of actual olive content in it, it tends to really cook at a lower temperature. So that smoke point being low is going to cause it to get bitter, and it's going to cause some really adverse effects to your cooking process. So you really want to make sure you're picking the right oil for the right task at hand. For a nice extra virgin olive oil, that you want to reserve for really its raw components. You want to use it on a salad, and a vinaigrette of that type of thing, or if you want to dip some nice bread in it, that's a great option as well. Okay. I'm just going to check our searing. You can see we've already got some amazing color there. That's exactly what we're looking for. And we want to make sure that we sear these on all sides, okay? So I'm just going to rotate these around. You can see that beautiful caramelization, exactly what we're looking for. And you can see that this is truly a labor of love. You know, you really take a lot of attention. The process cooks very quickly in terms of the initial stages, but as we get into the rest of the segments of it, this really becomes a labor of love because we're going to cook this low and slow. So as this is kind of going through the next stages, I'm going to talk through some of our other ingredients that we're going to build into this. Okay. Bring this up here. Okay. So really, this is a very classic representation of a classic French braise. We're going to be incorporating some standard mirepoix here to it. We've got about 4 ounces of roughly chopped carrot. We've got about 8 ounces of roughly chopped onions, and then about 4 ounces of roughly chopped celery. Now, the basic ratio for mirepoix is going to be 2 parts onion to 1 part carrot and 1 part celery. So that's why I've got about 8 ounces by weight of the onions to 4 ounces of each of the carrot and the celery. That's just your basic ratio. And when we talk about aromatics, which is what the mirepoix serves as, you can really get creative with it. You can add mushrooms to this if you want to. If you wanted to do a white mirepoix, you would add in parsnips as opposed to carrots. It's all about choosing the right types of ingredients for the desired outcome. Since we're making a beef-based element that's going to be, you know, a brown liquid at the end, we want that color. We want those carrots, that carotenoid element that's going to really fuel a lot of color and get that nice caramelization. So going to rotate our short ribs. As you transition from each side, they're going to start to cook faster. So that's something that you want to keep in mind. That first side is always going to take the longest. And so what I'm doing is I'm actually using the side of the pan to kind of get the ends of the short ribs so that they'll cook a little bit faster, trying to maximize our time and work as efficiently as possible. And you can see all of that fat starting to render. That's exactly what we want. That fat is going to be what we use to cook our mirepoix and build everything else, so we're not wasting this. If you have too much, you can dump a little bit of it out, but we're only doing about 4 portions of the short ribs today, so it'll be the perfect amount of fat for us to continue cooking our mirepoix and carrying on. So as those are searing, I'm gonna do a quick taste here, check on our potatoes. They're coming down nicely. Those are just about there, looking perfect. Actually gonna kill the heat there on those. Going to flip over our short ribs to our final side here. Perfect. You can see that beautiful coloration on there. It's exactly what we're looking for. And we're starting to develop a lot of really nice bond on the bottom of the pan. Those little brown bits that come off of the short ribs is really what's going to intensify our flavor. And a word that you as a young culinarian really want to focus on, the word bond. We're going to be producing a ton of bond as we work through this, from our vegetables to the meat and our tomato paste that we're going to add in a little bit. All of those things are really crucial to the building blocks. So I'm going to quickly get our short ribs out onto a clean plate so they can rest. Okay. Perfect. Just going to set those off to the side. And now we're going to quickly transition to getting our mirepoix into our pan. And we're going to start off with our carrots. Now, working with mirepoix, there's a lot of chefs that will just dump all three of these in at the same time. But something you want to be mindful of is that each ingredient has a different cooking time when you're working with it. Carrots are going to take a lot longer to cook through and a lot longer to caramelize than your onions and your celery. So something you want to be mindful of is to get your carrots started first when you're caramelizing them. Give them, let them go for about 2 minutes or so before you get started with your onions and your celery. So that way they caramelize at the same rate. Very important thing to keep in mind, because if you're waiting for these to caramelize when you've added all of these at the same time, by the time these are browned properly, your onions and your celery are going to be burnt to the bottom of the pan. So really want to be mindful to work with your ingredients in the way that they're intended. So just going to add a little bit of salt here to our carrots and a little bit of pepper. Not too much, because with salt and the seasoning, it actually pulls moisture out of ingredients. So with our aromatics, we want to be mindful of the amount of moisture we're pulling out of them so that they caramelize quicker and we get that nice rich color on them as soon as possible. So just going to give a quick stir here. Get these going. See, they're already starting to colorize on the bottom. Get some nice colorization and caramelization, I should say. And it's already starting to smell amazing in here, so we're just going to let those go for about a minute. I'm going to do a quick taste on our potatoes, which felt perfect just a minute ago, which is great. Perfect.
So what I'm going to do is I'm going to empty these out. Drain those out. Now, with our mashed potatoes, probably the most important step in the process is after you strain them out, return them back to the hot pan that they originally came in. The reason that we want to do this is so that we can get out some of that excess moisture. Moisture is going to be a key theme of what we're talking about today, because moisture can really play a lot of different hands. It can work to your benefit when we talk about the braising element of things, but when we talk about moisture and caramelization, it ruins that process. And when we talk about moisture going into our mashed potatoes, that's going to cause runny mashed potatoes, and that's the last thing we want. So I'm actually going to turn the heat on our burner just a little bit. I'm just going to spin these around a little bit until they start to get chalky. So we really don't need a lot of extra heat. A lot of the moisture is going to come out of these just from the residual heat. We'll leave those in there. Rubber spatch here. And you can see that moisture is already starting to come out. That chalkiness is starting to develop, which is perfect. Great. Let's rest for just a minute. Our carrots have already started to caramelize. I'm going to go ahead and add in our onions and celery now. Perfect. Again, I'm just going to add a little bit of salt and pepper here, not too much. A lot of the seasoning is going to come from the stock that we're going to add in just a little bit. So to go along with our mirepoix, once we get this caramelized in just a minute or so, put this really quickly. I'm gonna let that go down for just a couple of minutes. Now, you really wanna take your time with the caramelization process since we're kind of under the gun in terms of time. We're not gonna take these all the way down to a rich caramelized color, but in your mind, you wanna cook these for at least 5 to 10 minutes. That's the kind of length that you wanna have them cooking so you can generate as much flavor as possible, get them nice, rich, and brown, and carry on from there. So while those are going, what I'm going to do is actually press out our potatoes. I'm going to run them through our ricer. And one of the most important things aside from the moisture content with regard to your potatoes is going to be their texture. And one of the best ways to do that and accomplish the perfect texture is by using a potato ricer. Very inexpensive purchase. This is about $20 and it will be in your family forever, I can guarantee you, as long as you take care of it. I use this at the holidays for Thanksgiving every single year. Anytime I'm making mashed potatoes, this is what I go with. It's just a simple investment that goes a long way. Those handheld mashers are the last thing you want to be using because they're going to leave chunks and it's going to be lumpy. You want a nice, smooth, nice mashed potato. So we're going to go ahead and start to put these through our ricer. I'm going to grab my spoon here. Okay. I'm doing it right back here into the pot so that way I can add in our cream in just a little bit. So in a restaurant, one of the most important things that we work on is efficiency and multitasking. So right now, by making our mashed potatoes right now and letting our mirepoix cook down, we're actually doing ourselves a favor. So that way we're maximizing our time and working as efficiently as possible. Okay. I'm just gonna add a little bit more potato here. This is only gonna be about one portion. We don't need to really worry about getting it all in there. That to the side, and in here I have some heavy cream and some butter that I melted down earlier. Perfect. We want to incorporate that a little bit. Okay. Your pot is cooking down really nicely. As I said, we want to make sure that we get it a little bit darker than this, but what I'm going to do is I'm going to actually continue on to the next step in the process. Like I said, you want them to go for about 5 to 10 minutes at the minimum. The longer you can let these go, the more color you can get, the better off they're going to be. Okay, so to our mirepoix, we're gonna go ahead and add in about 2 tablespoons of tomato paste. Okay. We're gonna work this in and distribute it amongst our mirepoix, so that way we can get that nice and caramelized as well. Really within this, you wanna cook out your tomato paste for, again, about 3 to 4 minutes, just to the point where you start to see a nice rich rusty color, a nice rusty red color coming out of the mirepoix itself. Raw tomato paste can kind of have a nasty taste to it, so by cooking it down a little bit, it's gonna sweeten it, make it a little bit more flavorful, and you want it to kind of have almost the aroma of raisins, if you're familiar with that. So it's really gonna have that pungent sweetness and that really condensed flavor capacity, okay? It's looking great. Let that go for just a second. Okay. So now we have our cream, which I'm going to give that a quick whisk. You want to make sure that this is fairly hot. So very important, you don't want to just add cold milk to your potatoes. You want to make sure that they're at a nice temperature. So I had these heated up before. So we're going to add in a little bit here. Just a little bit at the start. We want to add this gradually because we can always add more, but you can never take out. So very important thing when you're looking for a specific consistency, you want to make sure that you leave yourself room for error, okay? Add a little bit more here, not too much. We want to use our whisk so we get some nice aeration there. Great. Quick taste and smell our mirepoix and our tomato paste is coming down really nicely, looking great. So go ahead and quickly add in our red wine. You're going to need about a cup or so of red wine here that we're going to add. So what this is going to do is it's going to not only deglaze the bottom of the pan, help get up some of those flavorful bits, but it's also going to add some nice acidity to it and really tie the whole dish together and give some nice elements of flavor there as well. So just a basic dry red wine you can use in this instance. If you don't want to use alcohol in any capacity, you can use a pomegranate juice, which I know sounds a little bit strange, but when you reduce it down, it has a really full-bodied effect that can really do a nice job of replacing the wine in this element. So really an important part of this when we talk about the fattiness of our short ribs, as I've mentioned kind of several times, the amount of fat that's in them plays a big part in the flavor. And this wine is going to help cut that fat a bit, little bit. That acidity is going to go a long way to building all of your flavors together. So once you want to reduce this down by half, that we can concentrate a little bit more. You can see how quickly that comes down. It's exactly what we're looking for. Okay. So we give a quick taste to our mashed potatoes. Make sure that they are good to go. Perfect. Wonderful. I'm just going to cover those so that they stay warm for service. Our wine is coming down nicely. So in this instance, we're going to add our meat back into our pan. So we've gone through this process. We've seared the meat. We added our mirepoix. We cooked that down, got that nice and caramelized. We added our tomato paste, got that nice ruby red color onto there. Deglazed our pan with some dry red wine. Now we're going to add in our short ribs that we seared off before. Get them back into our pot here. Perfect. Arrange them as so. Now we're going to add in about, you're gonna need about a liter or so of ground veal stock on hand, or you can use brown beef stock, whichever you prefer. And you want this to not be ice cold as well. You want it to be at a decent temperature. So that way it doesn't necessarily kill the temperature of your pot when it goes in there. So we're gonna go ahead and add that in. You just wanna add in enough stock so that it gets up to about 2/3 of the way of your short ribs. So I'm just gonna add it until we get there. And we're gonna just use it all. That's perfect. The absolute perfect level. You can see that the liquid comes right up to about 2/3 of the way. That way you have some of the meat exposed and you also have some of it submerged. That's that combination heat cooking. So what we're gonna do with it next is bring it up to a gentle simmer, and then we're gonna get it immediately into a 275 degree oven. Now, as I mentioned before, there's some basic differences between a braise and working with a stew. Now, a stew, you would do all of these same steps up until this point, where you would sear your meat, you'd do the mirepoix, all of those things combined together. But at this point, you would add enough stock or enough liquid so that it covers and fully submerges your meat, and you would bring it up to a simmer, and then you would leave it covered on your stovetop, and it would actually cook on the stovetop. The main difference in that regard is the fact that you're using a portion-sized piece of meat as opposed to the large, or I should say bite-sized pieces of meat for your stew. As you can see here, it's a much larger cut of meat, especially if you were going to do a braise on a brisket or something to that effect, a much larger piece of meat that you would then portioned down for service or after it was already cooked. Beforehand, when you're working with the stew, you're gonna make the bite-sized pieces ahead of time so that it's ready for service once it's cooked all the way through. So we're gonna let this come up to a gentle simmer. While we're doing that, I'm gonna add in two bay leaves, okay? Just gonna let those go. Now, like I said, once we get it up to a simmer, we're gonna get it covered with a lid. And then we're gonna quickly get it into our oven. So I'm going to quickly transition over to our oven here, which I've already got set at 275. And for short ribs, they should only take about 45 minutes or so to cook all the way through. But the thing that you wanna be mindful of is to make sure that you're checking them pretty regularly. So after about 30 minutes, I like to take them out of the oven, check them with a fork. What we're really looking for is a fork tender doneness on the short ribs. So I've actually got some that are already ready to go, which really excited to kind of get out of here. That I made these actually yesterday. And what a lot of restaurants would do is they will, when they're doing a braised item, obviously these are types of things that you can't do necessarily to order. So there's something that you have to prep ahead of time and really be mindful of that part of the process. So what you would ultimately do is make them the day before and actually chill them down in the cooking liquid. And then that way those meats actually soak up all of that flavor in the cooking liquid, really intensifies the flavor. And then you heat off a few of them for service, and that's how you kind of work through the process. So ultimately what we've got here is some beautifully fork tender short ribs that are raring and ready to go. Okay. So what we're gonna do next is we're actually going to take a little bit of our cooking liquid here, and we're going to make a quick sauce out of this. So we don't need a lot to get going. We just want enough sauce so that we can thicken it up a little bit. Now, I actually strained out our cooking liquid as well as once I took them out of the reach-in this morning. By doing that, it makes it more, a little bit easier to serve. Also, you don't necessarily need all that mirepoix just kind of floating around the entire time. So that's something to be mindful of as well. Okay. We're just going to get that going, let that cook down a little bit. Got some whole butter, which we're going to use to finish our sauce. Some fresh chive. It's going to clean up our station so that we can get ready for plating. So I've also got a little bit of slurry that I made ahead of time, which is really one of the more versatile thickeners that you're gonna find in restaurants. Probably the most common because it's pretty inexpensive. It's just a combination of equal parts cold water and cornstarch. So it's a really simple thickener that is a great way to not have any changes to the flavor outcome. If you're going to use a roux, that's obviously going to add flour and fat and some nutty notes to it. This is a neutral thickener, so it's not going to add any flavors to it. It's strictly going to be getting it to the consistency we want very quickly. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to taste this quickly. Just want to see where we're at in terms of the seasoning. That is really good already. I'm just gonna add a little bit of salt to this, a little bit of pepper. That's really, really tasty. And then what we're going to do is we're quickly going to finish this with a little bit of butter. So we call that monte au beurre, to be able to finish a dish with butter. That's exactly what we want with this. Okay, just a nice little stick of butter there. Perfect. So we're just going to let that cook down. I really wish that there was smell-o-vision right now so that you guys could smell the smells coming out of this kitchen right now, because that's one of the best parts about braising and anything that takes a long time to cook is the fact that your entire house or your entire kitchen is going to smell like love for the entire day that you work with it. So really one of my most favorite things to do on a Sunday when it's cold outside, like it's been because it's winter here in the Northeast, is to do a nice slow braise on a Sunday. Sadly, football's gone, so we don't have that to watch at the same time. But when you have your food and you have your cooking and following the steps, it's a great way to enjoy yourself inside. So we've got our butter worked in. Okay, we want to bring this up to just about a boil, so that way we can add in our slurry. Going to whisk this in really quickly. Shouldn't take too much to get the consistency we want. A little bit goes a long way. Now, to get your slurry to take effect, it needs to be at a boil, or at least a simmer. That heat is what's going to generate the starch molecules and cause it to thicken up. Without that, you're not going to get it thickened. So you can't just add it to a lukewarm sauce and have it do its thing. It needs to be up to the right temperature to generate that thickness. And what we're really looking for is a nappe type consistency, which is exactly what we have here. So our sauce is perfect. We're going to begin our plating now. So I'm going to get some mashed potatoes ready to go. Perfect. Nice big portion of mashed potatoes right here. Those aside. Now we're going to grab our tongs and we're going to plate up our short ribs, which are looking wonderful. We're going to use our potatoes as a way to really kind of prop these up, give them a little bit of love in the decoration department. Absolutely beautiful. Stack that up just like that. Perfect. I'm going to save the other two for meat for later. Now we've got our sauce ready to go. Perfect. Okay. I'm just going to drizzle this down on top. Get a nice little bit on our potatoes also. Honestly, can't get enough of the sauce, so we're just going to put as much of that as possible. Now, you can see how easy that was to really just take your cooking liquid, which really connects the flavor profiles and brings everything together really nicely, but you just cook it down, add some butter, it's glory. Right there, we're just going to finish it with a little bit of fresh chive. A bit of extra love there. And there you have it. Perfectly braised short ribs with whipped mashed potatoes. Enjoy.